All right, folks, welcome back. Our latest game, AlphaGo versus the world. And Michael, this is a repeat. We just had the same player last game and kind of fell apart early, but a little different story this time, right?
Well, in part, Junghwan again. He came back for seconds, or you might say fourth, because I think this is his fourth game.
Right.
Well, you know, with AlphaGo, falling apart, it's just a matter of time. But this is one of the rare games that actually went to half a point. But that's something that AlphaGo in this version was doing a lot. Like, it actually has a decisive lead fairly early. But since it's winning anyway, it decides to... I never get that. It decides to give a few points away in the end game. And it really worried me in a way. It's sort of hard to watch because I know that AlphaGo is probably working with 7.5-point Komi. Is it really understanding what's going on? So I think about that. But it turns out it won by half a point every time it did that. So I guess it was okay.
Yeah.
It's not really relevant to what I'm going to be talking about today because the game was pretty decisively in AlphaGo's favor. AlphaGo has white. So this is the way... This is the opening up to this point. The black way of playing here is what AlphaGo was liking to play in this series. So you could say he's playing the same opening. It was an opening that could be played by humans. But I think this became much more popular when people saw AlphaGo playing it.
Mm.
This large Shimari, the large Shimaris just were not so popular before AlphaGo, for this version of AlphaGo, that is. And this is how AlphaGo... counters that. AlphaGo does not play towards the right side. It likes to play this Shimari.
And can actually, let me just ask you that, because I have always liked large Shimaris, but, you know, not being a particularly strong player, I felt they were faster.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm just curious your sense of what the preference is for AlphaGo for the large Shimari.
Well, large Shimaris, actually, I always like large Shimaris. If you look back in the collection of my games that you have in Redmond Reviews and so, you will see that I play large Shimaris fairly often. And they are faster. So exactly as you were saying, they were faster. They have more influence towards the sides.
Mm-hmm.
They do become a bit of a headache in the middle game and after, when you don't know whether that's the territory or not.
Right.
And so when the game calms down, like, and you have not made full use of them towards the sides, maybe, then you have to worry about whether you're going to get that corner territory after all or not.
Right.
And humans really do tend to think about, of course, the player with more territory wins. So we're very attached to territory.
Sure.
But it works in a different way with computer programs because they actually... like, for instance, the idea of white attaching against the star point here, you can see that AlphaGo and the modern computer programs don't even try to take that territory away from black. They're more focused on getting quickly towards the sides. So speed and quick development is much more emphasized. And so basically having the big Shimari is just more efficient if you're going to get that territory anyway. Or actually, even if you're just thinking that the side is more important.
Right.
So I just like them. But people were bothered by the fact that that's not a black territory yet. And really, if you look back at some of my games, you will see that quite often it becomes an issue later in the game when, in this case, it's white, when the opponent tries to invade that large knight's move. Sometimes you can just run out of territory.
Mm-hmm.
Because you play two moves in that corner and you don't have a real territory there.
Right. That makes
and
sense.
Obviously, the real problem happened before you lost that territory. Maybe you've made a mistake before that.
Right.
But the apparent loss is when your opponent takes the territory away. So that's why humans have a problem with that. They don't like it.
Good. Thank you.
But I think we're learning.
I hope so.
Mm-hmm. And here we see the way white is playing that. Playing away after playing the Kakari here, white plays away. This is just like we're seeing in modern Go and with computer programs. And black plays here. Splitting the side, you know, it's not the move that computer programs play like they play this. The attachment against the Shimari. I really love this move. It's exciting. I've played this a number of times. In fact, this is another move that you've seen in some of my commentaries, think about my own games. Or black would pincer on the upper side. That would be a normal move. Just the sides are not so emphasized anymore. I don't think this move in itself is going to lose so many points. As far as the computer score, the generated score is, it's not going to go down so much. It's just that the computer programs, they're not choosing. The networks are not choosing these moves.
Do you think somebody would play that big splitting move these days, or really not?
Like, there's some players who are just refusing to play the AI style who would maybe play that. But most of the young players would definitely not. You would see them doing stuff like this. I really like this, Joseki.
Okay.
Yeah. Give me a chance. I'll talk about that one.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so black pincers now. Up to this point, it's okay. Still pretty even. And we get this Joseki. In this case, it makes sense. Since black does have that pincer, it makes sense for white to be taking the corner territory. So this is what a human would do. It's very standard, nothing unusual. Sort of the expected variation here. Okay, this extension, maybe the Kakari was bigger. Yeah, because after white plays here, there is a very small change in the score that Katago gives, and white has 51%. So that's 49% for black. And it's maybe like, that means it's maybe a half point or 1.5 points that black is losing. It's not something that, it's not something that I would even notice. It would be impossible to understand. I wouldn't be calculating the score at this point anyway. But it makes sense that I would probably choose this move just by intuitively. It's a more natural move developing from this stone.
Well, and you want to give that stone a little help.
Yeah. But black's strategy, you might say, in this game is to sort of leave that stone, and black's going to try to build a big moyo in the center of the board. So that was black's strategy here. And this would be quite effective against the human player. Black plays here. Black's consolidating the right side. So a lot depends on how white can come in here. And this is a very difficult position for human players to find the best invasion point. Like, invading deeply, I would be in danger of losing the whole group. Like, it's very, a lot of calculation is necessary. Black could have played, this is a move that is more fast-paced and more like what people would do now. Black would just push from this side, and it would be more direct. It would be more forceful against the white group on the left. And if white pushes around like this, then you can see that black is building the moyo on a large scale. So this would be the more modern way of playing. It would be the more natural way to play, just attaching against white shimari there. But playing here, black is taking a very strong grasp on the right side. And personally, I would be a bit intimidated if I was thinking of invading deeply in the side. I would be very worried as to whether I could pull it off.
Mm.
So white plays a shoulder hit and dives in.
So of course.
Here we have the superior calculation abilities of AlphaGo are being demonstrated here. And for reasons that are really hard for me to understand, Katago is already giving white a pretty high winning percentage, 57%.
Wow.
So that's like 3.5 points. Black plays here, white plays here once. And now white plays this hane. Turns out this hane was extremely effective. Because black, in order to take advantage of black's local advantage here, black has all of these stones on the right side. Black has to play very forcefully. Like, if black could just simply play something like this, then white could probably, I don't know, maybe I'd have white play something like this. Something like this. It looks fairly easy for white to live on the side. Like, black has to play more strongly than that. So black cut here and covers. Black's going to kill this white group. So white curls around and black connects. This sort of makes sense. White plays a hane. Now, this is the game move. This is sort of an interesting move. Another way for Black to kill this would have been to play.
I was just trying to read that out, yeah.
Either way, Black can kill it. Actually, the game move works okay. White plays here, and it's dead.
Right.
Well done, right? You would think it's a good job by Black. But at this point, White's over 60%.
Are you serious?
And it's the Black player who's going to be forced to crawl on the second line here. Just to show you a few more moves. Black crawls around here.
Black is crawling on the second line. Must be good, right?
Must be good. It doesn't work when humans do it. Just to remind you what the situation here is, White has five liberties in the corner. So in order to win a race to capture against this white group, this MAI, Black would need five liberties. So Black could do that by crawling a couple more times on the second line. But ideally, Black does want to secure a connection sort of with this stone and the stones on the second line.
Uh-huh.
And because of the cutting point here, that is going to be possible. So Black, the tesuji for Black is to crawl as far as possible and then cover here. So this is the game move. And this works because it's by crawling as far as possible, Black is getting, I shouldn't have marked the stones, maybe these points. Black is getting as many liberties as possible. And when I say crawling as far as possible, I mean crawling as far as Black can and still be able to close off the side like this. So in this case, if White had continued, Black would be able to surround White from the center, and Black would win the semi. And that's just because Black has extended the liberties of this group as much as possible.
Wow.
It means Black's winning by one move. Like, if Black had done that one move too early, then it would have been a different story. Like, if Black had done it now,
right,
it's pretty obvious that this is going to be a one-move loss for Black.
Yep.
So the point is that Black is going to crawl as far as possible and then cover on the third line. And Black gets to connect on the first line, but it's a bit painful. And it turns out that all these stones on the first line were just not good enough. And so I'm going to stop here, but actually this is one of the games that went to half a point.
Uh-huh.
At this point in the game, it's probably close before Komi. So White should be winning by something like 6.5 points. And I was very annoyed every time AlphaGo did this in the master version. It would just give away points in the end game. And it would stop giving away points when it was winning by half a point. So that was something that bothered me. But it didn't turn out to make any losing mistakes, so I guess it was okay.
Yeah, yeah. And interesting here that Park actually does make a game out of it by, I mean, he's behind, but he keeps it relatively close. So this is, I think, it's a more interesting, you know, in the game, the last game we looked at, which was very slicey dicey.
Well, he did succeed in killing this corner group. So
yeah,
the mission that he set out to accomplish was accomplished. It's just that White did manage to reduce the Moyo quite effectively here. You have to remember that this whole area was this huge territorial framework that Black had, and it's pushed down to the first and second lines. So that's how White's sequence here is working.
Well, to your point, because I was looking at the same thing, when you look at Black's framework, where do you come in? And thinking about it, I certainly wasn't thinking, I know what I'll do. I'll sacrifice a pretty big group in the corner and then force Black to crawl along the second line. And then I'll have this nice little group running out. That's a pretty devious plan.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, definitely.
Wow. Very, very cool. All right, as always, Michael, thank you so much. I know you've really studied these games deeply, and these are fun. You know, these are really kind of cool. And just a reminder to folks, you know, we are doing all 60. That's why we're giving you these sort of focused main points, but it's okay. We'll get more into it in Volume 2 of AlphaGo to Zero. I'm not even going to say when it's going to come out because we don't know. We're working on it. We'll put it that way. We're working on it. So in the meantime, enjoy the videos, and we'll see you next game.